How about it, church? Yeah? How about some ancient words for you this morning? Some timeless, truth, living, active, ancient world. You ready for that? All right, so grab your Bibles with me if you would. We are in 1 Peter and chapter 3 today. Our ushers are in the aisles. Good morning, ushers. Good morning, ushers. So faithful are ushers. Look at all the Bibles they bring to us. So if you need one, just get their attention as they're passing by your row. If you're into the electronic deal, then you can go to the App Store and grab the Horizon app. Grab a good Bible app and 1 Peter chapter 3. If you're into taking some notes, we got an outline for you in the bulletin. And that outline is also on the app, so you can fill it in electronically and download it or email it to yourself. But why don't you stand with me, okay? Let's all stand, really in the respect and the reverence of reading this passage together in 1 Peter chapter 3. And we're going to continue right on here in our Gracism series. And looking at wives today, but I've actually called it Gracist Brides. No one's left out. We're all brides. We're part of the bride of Christ, and just learning to be more gracious with each other and more gracist out there in the world. So follow along with me and just soak this in, these ancient words that can just, I'm telling you what, they can revolutionize your life and restore your marriage and redeem your heart and just fill you with all of the goodness of the Lord. Amen? So here we go. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1. Wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives. Maybe you're here today and your husband isn't because he doesn't believe. Or maybe he's here today, he came with you, but he's not into it, he doesn't believe. Or maybe he does believe, because I think this would also apply, he does believe, but lately he's kind of been disobedient to the word of God. He's in a backslidden sort of a season. So that would apply as well. And you could also reverse the roles and apply it where you've got this husband who's really living for the things of the Lord and his wife just isn't into it. I don't know if it could be more practical for us because here's the plan of attack, how you would approach such a situation. You wouldn't leave, you wouldn't quit. You would follow the leading of the Lord here. Where clearly it's declaring, especially, listen, to the wives, be submissive, even in that situation, to your own husbands. That even if some are not obeying, they're disobeying, they're not believing, they, without you saying a single word, might be won by the conduct that is seen in their wives. When they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear, and that's not a fear like I'm afraid of the Halloween costumes. It's not a fear like, oh no, I'm, you know, freaked out. It's a reverence. It's a respect. It's an honor. It's a word for having an awe for the things of the Lord, that they would see in you and observe a chaste conduct accompanied by respect and an awe and reverence. And don't let, verse 3, your adornment be merely outward, ranging of hair and the wearing of gold and the putting on of fine apparel. Rather, it be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. I don't know where that section is in anthropology. They got a section for absolutely everything else, but where's that section? An incorruptible beauty, where's that in Nordstrom, right? Of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very, everyone say very. Very, not just precious, very precious in the sight of God. He loves this. He digs it. It's what he's looking for. It's very precious to him. For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also adorned themselves. It's not like adorning yourself is bad or wrong. Like the entire book of Song of Solomon is written about this gal who's just adorning herself. But it wasn't everything she was living for. There was more to life than just the outward adorning. But here, look at, in former times, holy women trusting in God, they also adorned themselves with what? With being submissive to their own husbands. Example? Well, the one Peter gives is Sarah. Look at verse 6. And Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. Okay, that's a small L, not a capital L. Don't know how that goes over in 2016. Calling him Lord. But it's this picture of Sarah's heart, right? Of Sarah's beauty. Of Sarah's reverence. Obeying Abraham, calling him Lord. Whose daughters you are. So Peter's believing the best in you, wives. Believing that if you hear this, receive this, if you get this, that you're part of this. You're part of the faith of Abraham and Sarah. Whose daughters you are if, big if here in verse 6, big condition, big if you... what? Do good and are not afraid with any terror. Now, that word afraid is different than the earlier verse, which meant respect and reverence and awe. This word afraid really means afraid, like terrorized, like afraid of it, afraid of going near it, afraid of having anything to do with it. With what? With submission. So, Lord, I pray in these next few moments, you'd change our hearts towards this topic. For every woman here, here's my desire, here's my challenge today, that instead of dreading it, they would desire it. And in desiring it, they would delight themselves in it, Lord, because it certainly is something that you see as being very precious in your sight. And so, Lord, stir our hearts in this series for more grace in our marriages, and especially today, for these precious wives, for these incredible wives, these ladies that are here, and the husbands next weekend, as we fix our sights on them and continue in this passage. We do it all for your glory in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. You may be seated. Okay, the next verse says, here's where we'll pick it up next week, and hope you can come back, part two next weekend in this look at marriage. The next verse, verse 7 says, husbands likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel. Doesn't mean you're weak, ladies. Okay, I'll get to that next week and hang with me. Come back for that. Giving honor to the weaker vessel as being heirs together of the grace of life. This is a series we've called Gracism. Gracist Brides, Gracist Husbands. Being heirs together of the grace of life that your prayers may not be hindered. So that's the word there, verse 7. We'll pick up next week for the husbands. And wives, you're like, well, now wait a minute. You got 6 verses for the wife. You got 1 for the husband? Seems a little unfair there. I'm just the mailman today. I'm just delivering the mail. But... is it unfair? Grab your outline with me. Fill this top line in with me, would you? That when it's weighted properly, submission is weighted equally. Okay, fill that in. I worked on it all week long, okay? And I think it'll change everything where your perspective of submission is concerned. That when it's weighted, and it is a weight... okay, let's be clear. This is a weight. It's a weight. But when it's weighted in the balances, in the scales, when it's weighted properly, submission is weighed, what? It's weighted equally. It is. Ladies, gals, it is. We could go to Ephesians chapter 5 if you want. And even before it kind of lays out the roles for a wife and a husband, it weights them equally and says we are mutually submitted one to another before the Lord. So it is weighted equally when it is weighted properly. So actually, when you look at 6 verses being for the wife and 1 verse being for the husband, I can still come before you and say it is equally weighted in its distribution. In fact, look at verse 7 with me again. What does it say? Husbands, what's the next word? Likewise. In other words, all 6 verses that I just shared where it pertains to the wife also apply to you as husbands? So, you know, if you want to weigh it out, he actually gets 7 verses and gals, you get 6. So here's really the weighting of this powerful word of submission. It's one verse. Let me give it to you. It's not on the outline, but it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3, it says this. Here is the weighting I'm talking about, the proper balancing of submission. And here's the verse. It says this. I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ. The head of every man is Christ. Okay, so gals, you can just like relax and rest in the fact that he ain't in charge. There's somebody ruling over him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. This is submission. Submission properly seen as being equally distributed. So look at that verse for a second and think about it. Does it reduce the role of Jesus in any way to say that he is submitted to God? No, we know that Christ is equal to God. And so why for any moment would we think that it reduces the role of the wife? It doesn't. I'm going to prove it to you today. And my goal really all week in studying this and preparing this and putting this together is to move you from dreading this topic like fingernails on a chalkboard. Oh, it's the S word this Sunday. To actually desiring this, and in desiring it, delighting it, because we're not in any way, you know, saying that you're inferior because of this role of submission. You're not. You're equal in gifts, in worth. It's just a different role. It's just a different role that's being lived out. There's an amazing passage in Matthew chapter 8. If you want to look at it later as families or as a couple, it's a great chapter where so much ministry is going on and people are being healed. It's really incredible. And not just Jewish people, although Jewish people are being healed in Matthew chapter 8 and the lame are walking and the blind are seeing. But in Matthew chapter 8, the centurion comes along, this Roman official. Like, talk about, you know, just, you know, kind of like, I mean, that would have been like the enemy to the crowd that was now following Jesus, like totally outside the camp. Like, what's he doing here? He represents Rome and all that is, and we've looked at that in 1 Peter chapter 2, that we're to submit to the government. And when Peter writes, the government is Nero. And he is torching Christians like candlesticks. Like, it's even worse, if you can imagine, than the politics and governments that surround us in this very moment. It was worse back then when Peter writes it and says, I want you to submit to the government. And then I want you to submit to your boss, even though your boss is a creep. That was last week. We saw that in chapter 2. And now he's coming to the brides and he's saying to the brides, I want you to submit to your husband, even when he's being a goof. Even when he's not submitting himself to Christ, even when he's being disobedient, even when he's backslidden, even if he doesn't believe in any of this stuff at all. And that would have been the same pressure of the crowd wanting to persuade Jesus to not reach out and heal the centurion in Matthew chapter 8. But Jesus reaches out and he heals the centurion as if this Roman centurion is equal in its value to this chosen race and people known as Israel, equal in the eyes of the Lord. And not only in Matthew chapter 8 are the men being healed, but guess who else gets healed in Matthew chapter 8? Peter's mother-in-law. So the women, you know, it does say in Scripture that there is now, therefore, neither Jew or Greek, male or female, bond or free, all are one in Christ. And Matthew 8 absolutely proves it because he's healing everybody. He's healing everybody. And at the end of Matthew chapter 8, as a result of all of this healing that is going on for the woman, for the mother-in-law, for the centurion, for the lame, for the blind, for the Jew, for the Gentile, there's a guy in Matthew chapter 8. Read it later. It's great. He comes along and he goes, I want to sign up. I want to follow you. And you know what Jesus says? Awesome. Join the team. That's not what Jesus says. That's what I say all the time. Awesome. Join the team. Jesus doesn't say that. Jesus doesn't say, the more the merrier, everybody in. He actually looks at the guy who has now said, I want to follow you too. And Jesus says, the foxes have holes and the birds have nests. I'm homeless. I have no place to lay my head tonight. So are you sure you want to follow me? And the guy's like, I want to follow you. And he's like, have you really seriously considered what you're giving up? What you're going to surrender? What you're submitting yourself to? Now, if you're here today and you're like, I don't care what you say, dude. This truly, it just makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up. I am not into submission. I just would have to, you know, let me just help you draw the conclusion of that thinking that you can't be saved without submitting. That's what Jesus ultimately is saying to the guy. Have you considered the cost of the surrender in signing up to follow me? Because I'm like, well, everybody who's saying, I want to follow Jesus, I'm like, yes, awesome, join the team. And Jesus is like, hold on, because the foxes are going their home and the birds are going to their home. I got no home. Are you still in? And another guy comes along and he says, well, I'm in. I want to follow you, but my dad just died, so I have to go bury my dad. That to me sounds like a pretty good excused absence. I got a funeral here. I got to bury my dad. It doesn't happen every day. Like, it happens once. And Jesus says, let the dead bury the dead. You follow me. That's harsh. That's like to all of us in San Diego, what's still in the way? What's still in the way, Charlie, from you truly surrendering your life and submitting to Jesus? Girl, I got this and I got that. And once this lines up, then maybe I'll consider it. And then if I can just... And he's like, there is no salvation without submission. There's no salvation without a surrender. I can't just raise my hand and pledge my allegiance to Jesus without also surrendering to his lead, surrendering to his lordship. And this now is what is displayed in marriage. It's what's displayed in marriage. And it's weighted properly, and it's weighted equally, and it is lived out accordingly so that people would see what Jesus is truly calling us to. And if you're like, well, I'm not gonna submit. You're like, you know, when God speaks about the Israelites in the wilderness, what's he call them? Do you remember what he calls them? Stubborn, stiff-necked, you know, right? What does that mean? Unsubmissive folks. They're just like, I'm not going that way. I'm doing it my way, and who are you to tell me how to live? Listen, if you don't want to submit, don't get married. And if you don't want to submit, you also can't be saved. That's the importance of this subject that we look at together today. And yeah, I know, I get it, primarily through the role of the wife, but we're all the bride. We're all the bride of Christ. And he's using even this message to remind us and show us, church, listen, to show us why we're still here on earth and not up in heaven on this glorious Lord's Sunday morning, which is where we all would rather be. But we're here. Why are we still here? Why are we still down here? Why are we still down here? Thank you. Grab your outline. Let me tell you why. Let me tell you why by answering this on the outline as to the ultimate design and goal of submission. Do you know what it is? Do you know what it is? Fill this in with me on your outline. And this is the most important thing. You can put the rest aside if you want, but this one you got to fill in with me. The ultimate design, the reason why you're still down here on earth and not in heaven this morning. The reason you're going to hold things together in your marriage, even when your marriage is the most difficult place for you to dwell. The reason you're going to hang in there is because the ultimate design and goal of submission is, you ready? Here it is. Here's the word. You know what the word is? Holy doesn't start with an I. I'm spelling the word for you. I. You know what it is? And?
Intuition.
F. L. NFL! Yes! Woo! That's it! No. You? Okay, you got it. What is it? What is it?
Influence.
Influence. Influence. Influence. The ultimate design and the goal. And the reason that you're on the planet right now and you're not standing and singing and praising around God's throne of grace is influence. And the reason that a wife is called to submit to her husband, you might not have ever seen it this way before. And I believe this word is what can free you from dreading it to now desiring it, because your role is influence. In fact, Peter has given us three surrounding environments that we are to sway with our influence. The first one, you remember last time, is the world. This world that we're living in, this government. And he says, I want you to submit to all ordinances of man. And you're like, submit to ordinances of man? Do you know what the ordinances are that are coming down the pike? Yep. As unto God, I want you to submit to every ordinance of man. Because when you submit, you have influence. Dude, I think you're nuts, man. I think you're crazy. The influence actually is what would then allow them to take advantage of me. You have severely misunderstood and underestimated the power of your influence and who you're submitting to. You're submitting unto the Lord. Even when Nero's running the world, Peter writes and says, unto the Lord, where this global initiative of secularism is concerned, you have an opportunity to influence that surrounding environment. And when you go to work tomorrow, in your workplace, even when the boss is a creep, even when he's a louse, even when he's a cheat, submit, because there you have influence. And wives, within your homes, families. See, the moment you go superior, the moment you pull the superiority card, the superiority card isn't going to change the climate of politics. The superiority card, you know, when we kind of like go, it's actually in the surrendering that the freedom and the victory is found. The moment you pull a superiority card in your marriage, you've actually lost the influence. But the influence that you gain, dear gals, dear ladies, as your pastor, I'm begging you, don't lose your influence over your man. I need you helping me with him. We'll get to him next week, both barrels. But if you bail, if you chuck it, if you're like, he didn't do anything, why should I submit to him? I'm the one that's holding the whole thing together. And you go like superiority on him, which is your nature according to Genesis 3. You've lost all influence to change him. You know what, Pastor? Honestly, I think I have a better sermon to preach than you do. Yeah, well, Peter's saying, not with the words. Like there's something actually more weighted and significant and important than your words. Who you are, this role that you fill, this influence that you have, it is so much more powerful than your words. In fact, turn with me to 1 Corinthians 7. Right there on the outline is a passage that I want you to see where Paul sort of breaks this whole thing down from the aspect now of seeing it within marriage, within the home. We've seen it within government. We've seen it within the workplace. And we're seeing it now lived out within the home. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, I'm going to leave the first 9 verses to you at your leisure to look at and apply to your life. Just because of time, I'm picking it up in verse 10, halfway through in chapter 7, verses 10 through 16. Look what he says. Paul writes and he says, 1 Corinthians 7, verse 10, now to the married I command, yet not I, but the Lord. Okay, he's like a name dropper. That's like dropping the really big name. This isn't me. I'm just a mailman. This is the Lord. This is huge. Hone into this. Check this out. A wife is not to depart from her husband. That's not from Paul. Paul's like, this is not from me. This is from the Lord. It's a command from the Lord. We had a really cool couple in our church a number of years ago. This goes back to a number of years. And they started coming to church. They weren't saved. They were coming on campus for other things and kind of a little bit intrigued and curious about the whole deal. And they end up getting saved. And then she met as a wife, she met with my wife. The two wives kind of got together and she's kind of sharing her heart with Bonnie. And she was on the verge of divorcing her husband. And now she's gotten saved and she's like, wait a minute, are you telling me that I can't divorce him anymore? And Bond's like, well, you know, it kind of says right here that a wife is not to depart from her husband. So she didn't. She didn't. She hung in there and God's done a miraculous work in their marriage. It's been awesome. It's been incredible. It's been great. Just know he's gonna bless you for this. He's gonna bless you for this. And you're like, well, I already departed. I already left. I already divorced. I can't preach to your past. Believe me, I would love to. I'd love to get the DeLorean and go back in time, and I would preach to your past. Big time. I can't. All I can do is preach to your present right now and say, from this moment on, we're going forward. And you're not gonna divorce him. You're not gonna depart. You're not gonna. Well, what if I do? Next verse. Even if she does depart, let her remain unmarried. Okay. Well, I was really lonely in my marriage. Okay. Well, now you're all alone. Great. Or be reconciled to her husband. And a husband, you want to reverse the roles, Paul's happy to do it. And a husband is not to divorce his wife. Okay, so the same command, both sides of the aisle. The husband's not to divorce his wife either. But to the rest, I, not the Lord, say, if a brother has a wife, a brother, that's a Christian, in the fold, in the family, a brother has a wife who does not believe, and she's willing to stay, she's willing to live with him, then let him not divorce her. It's not a reason to get divorced. And a woman who has a husband who does not believe, this is exactly what Peter's talking about in chapter 3, if he's willing to live with her, let her not divorce him. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife. That doesn't mean he's saved, it means he's blessed. He's blessed just by being around her. He's blessed by being, you know, this close to one that is truly desiring to live out their life, not the way the rest of North County is living or the rest of our society wants to live, but the way the Lord is calling for us to live. He's blessed just being around her. The unbeliever is blessed, sanctified by the believer that's under the same roof. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but now they're holy. It doesn't mean they're saved either. It means in this time and season before they reach an age of accountability, there is a covering and a blessing because of that believer that although they are unequally yoked, have decided not to pack up and leave, not to bail, not to quit, not to divorce, but to stay in there. There's a blessing. There's a benefit. But if the unbeliever does leave, verse 15, if the unbeliever departs, let him depart. A brother, that's a Christian, a brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God has called us to peace. So if you're wondering, well, what is the biblical justification for divorce? There it is right there. There's the justification for the divorce. If the unbeliever decides to leave, you got to let him go. And you're not under bondage if you let him go in such cases. You can remarry and God wants you to be at peace. Then he says this, interesting twist, verse 16. For how do you know, O wife, whether you will save your husband? How do you know, let's reverse the roles, O husband, whether or not you'll save her, whether you'll save your wife? Here's some thoughts, four of them real quick that I jotted down this week as I was praying and just believing God for your marriages. It's your marriages that make this church healthy. Okay, so I'm like pouring into them and wanting to make them all the more healthier, amen? It's your marriages that are your witness. I don't care what you say and who you say you love and who you say you believe. If your marriage is a train wreck, so I'm like pouring into making sure that your marriage is as strong as it can be. And here's some things I think that'll help. I hope they do. I really pray that they do. Number one, God is often working in ways that you aren't aware. Well, I want to see it. I know I want to see it too. I want to see it so bad. But the Bible says we don't live by what we see. Faith comes by hearing, not by seeing. Well, I want to see it. I know, I so want to see it too. But faith comes by hearing, not by seeing. We walk by faith and not by sight. And so he's often working. He's working behind the scenes. And he's working under the surface in ways that you aren't even aware. Secondly, your influence, your godly influence is, guess what? It's influencing. Well, I didn't sign up for that. I don't want to. You're tough. Too bad. You're going to influence in one way or another. It just matters whether it's going to be a godly influence or a not so godly influence. You're going to be a witness whether you want to be a witness this next week or not. The only question is, what are you going to witness for? So your godly influence is actually influencing. Like if you plant some seeds in your garden, church, like you're planting some seeds in your garden, you're not going to dig the seeds up unless you're three. If you're three, you're going to get impatient. You're going to be like, I don't know if they're still in there. I can't even remember if I actually planted them right in the same row. You're digging them up, looking to see if they're still there. And it totally thwarts the process of them becoming all that they are designed to become. You got to let God work. You got to believe that even when you're not seeing it, he is faithful to do and to work in us and to complete and perfect in us unto the day of Christ Jesus, that even though you can't see it, like this is totally my life on a Sunday night. You got to know, like, three things are happening in my life. First of all, I'm totally exhausted every Sunday. Given it all. I've just given it all on the field. It's a good tired. It's a good exhaustion. I'm wiped out, and the devil knows it. So the devil starts to seed my heart with all sorts of evil seeds of doubt. Like, well, that sucked. You did horrible this weekend. And I start feeling like, oh, man, I wish I could have said that different. And if I could have done that differently. And ultimately, thirdly, I have to submit. And surrender and believe that his word never returns void. And as jacked up as a communicator as I might be from time to time, he's faithful. And he's going to complete the work. And you got to believe he's completing a work in you, even if you aren't aware of what the work is. And he is using your influence to influence. Thirdly, if he decides to leave, you got to let him. Let him. But don't drive him out. Don't drive him out. Well, I think I'm through with this marriage. Okay, can I drive you to the bus station? No, you don't. Like, can I pack for you? God gave me a word, Samsonite. Yeah, can I pack the bags for you? Can I move all your clothes out onto the curb? No, if they want to leave, you got to let them leave. But you're not the reason. You're not driving them out. Let me start the car. No, you're hanging in there. Believing that God is using you even in ways that you aren't aware. Fourthly, how do you know, right? Doesn't Paul nail this in chapters? How do you know that your influence, your submission to this? Well, I'm not going to submit. I'm just sitting on the couch. What is there to submit to? How do you know that you're not going to win him over? How do you know? You're not going to win her over, gentlemen. If you're the one in church today wishing so much that your wife was sitting next to you, how do you know that hanging in there isn't going to be enough for the Lord to use your influence to push them over the line? Praise God. Back to 1 Peter. Turn back to 1 Peter with me. I think Paul does a great job of laying out a foundation for us. In fact, 1 Peter does too. Let me give you a bit of a foundation if you missed last weekend. Or even if you were here, now applying it not solely to how we see the government and not solely to how we see the workplace tomorrow, but now as it pertains to our homes and our marriages and our families, because I know there's a lot of us in the room right now. We find ourselves in a pickle. We find ourselves wanting to please the Lord, wanting to be used for his glory, and wanting out of this marriage. I talk to singles all the time, singles that are just desperately desiring to be married. Well, let me tell you, there's something worse than you not being married. It's being married to the wrong person. And now in that situation, how does one who wants to honor Christ respond? Bob, give me some help on this. Where are the how-tos that I can apply specifically, practically? Hey, all the answers are in the book. They're not my answers, they're his answers. And chapter 2 is filled with these answers. Let me give them to you. The praise of submission, the pattern of submission, the purpose of submission, and the priority submission. That's like every P word I could come up with except the pressure. Because some of you feel you live under the pressure of submission. You hate it. And my goal all week has been to put something together that would relieve you of the pressure and cause for you to begin to see the praise of submission, the praiseworthiness of your submission, the pattern, the purpose, the prayer. It's all in the book. Look at verse 19. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 19. For this is, what's he say? It's the word commendable. Let me give you another word, praiseworthy. This is praiseworthy if because of conscience towards God, one endures grief. Now you're talking my language, Bob. I'm enduring so much grief in this marriage. Okay, listen, listen. It is praiseworthy for you not to bail. Look what it says. For this is commendable. Because of conscience towards God, if one endures grief, suffering wrongfully, for what credit is it if you're being beaten for your fault? Like the mess that you're in is because of your own fault. What credit is it? But if you're in that mess, doing good and suffering, you're taking it patiently, this is commendable. He uses the word twice. Commendable. This is praiseworthy before God. Here's how I filled it in on the outline. The praise of submission is that it makes God glad. Now, we're always looking for passages in Scripture. We just want to know what makes him happy. We want to please the Lord. We want to be able to know when it's all said and done that he's going to look at us and say, well done, wife. Well done, husband. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. What makes him happy? What pleases him? What makes God glad? Submission. Even in situations that are far from perfect. Because if he would, Bob, if he would only do this, here's what I hear from wives. If he would only do this. But you know what? He won't. But if he would, but he won't. You know why he won't? Because he can't. Let me tell you what happens to every guy when he's told he won't because he can't. He won't. What is praiseworthy unto the Lord is submission. And the pattern is Jesus. That ought to just relieve you of the pressure. You're not the pattern. I'm not the pattern. Peter's not even the pattern. Peter has had such a problem with submission. I mean, how many times does Peter have to remove one's foot from one's mouth? Peter's had a problem until he realizes the pattern of submission is Jesus. That's verse 21. For to this you were called, because Christ suffered, leaving us an example, that you should follow his steps. He is the pattern. How do you get there, Bob? How do you get to the point of allowing this pattern to be followed in your life and in your marriage? Thirdly, the purpose of submission is surrender. You got to surrender. You got to surrender to it. No one gets saved without surrendering. No marriage is held together without surrendering to each other. Surrender, and it's where the freedom is found. I'm telling you what, it's what sets you free. This is how the ultimate world war is won. The victory is in the surrender. And so, the purpose of submission is to get you to the surrender. That's verse 23. When he was reviled, he didn't revile in return. It's such a tit for a tat in so many marriages. Well, if he, then I. No, when he was reviled, he didn't revile in return. He surrendered. And when he suffered, he did not threaten back. He surrendered. And in his surrendering, he set us free. That's the purpose of submission. And number four, ultimately, the priority of submission is verse 25. Look at verse 25 in chapter 2. For you were like sheep going astray, but have now returned. Remember that from last week? The prodigal son, he returns. You were going the wrong way. You were living for the wrong things. You were like sheep going astray, but you've now returned to the shepherd and the overseer of your souls. You know what that word overseer is? The authority of your souls. The authority. Submission is actually a military term. It means to bring oneself under the authority so that the ultimate priority of submission, get this on your outline, is to return to his authority, to his reign, to return to his reign over your life. Wow, huge, so impactful. That's the influence of submission. Oh, I just hope and pray that that breathes God's gift of life, like he breathes into the lungs of Adam and he becomes a living soul, that your marriage would just come alive in seeing submission in a whole new light, with a different spirit, and a desire to stay in the game and not to quit, but to be the one that is there allowing God to use you to influence. Now, gals, how is that lived out? Is clearly in accordance to what Peter shares in chapter 3. Look what he says again. Be submissive to your husband, even if they're not obeying the word, that without saying a word, you may win them. They may be won by the conduct. There's something more powerful, in other words, there is something more powerful than your words. It's your behavior, it's your conduct. It's your faith on display. That without even saying a word, they would be won. When they observe your chaste conduct, accompanied by that awe, that reverence, that respect for the Lord. Bonnie has that. I can honestly witness and proclaim to you publicly that my wife's got it. And you know why she's got it? Because of who she's married to. And before you think that's some arrogant statement, who's she married to?
Jesus.
Who's she married to?
Jesus.
She's married to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Yeah. Well, who are you then? I'm still trying to figure that out, actually. I am some schlup, some schmuck. I am some very limited, part-time representative of who she ultimately is married to and will be for all eternity.
Amen.
And I'm doing my best to love her as he loves her. I'm doing my best at it. I'm not saying I'm perfect at it. I'm saying I know she's married to Jesus. And the moment you realize that is the moment your heart towards your wife shifts and changes. The moment she realizes she's married to Jesus is the moment her heart also shifts and changes for the better. We barely made it out of year one. We barely made it out. It was by God's grace. And some people that surrounded our lives and influenced us for the glory of Jesus' name. I got 130 full-time staff that report to me on this campus. Well, man, 130, that must be awesome. You just like get to bark out all the rules. Listen, it's their role that influences me in being the pastor that I've become. And if they weren't doing that role, they were bailing and quitting on me left and right, and I give them far too many reasons to bail and quit on a daily basis. But I think of the guys that have hung in with me for 10, for 12, for 15, for 18 years, holding up my arms and influencing me to be the pastor that God has called me to be. Bon has done the same thing in our marriage. She has influenced me. She gets this. She gets what Peter is talking about. And she is so close to the heart of the Lord in all of this that it isn't so much just the outward adornment of verse 3, the arranging of the hair, the wearing of the gold, the putting on of the apparel. And that's not all bad. We're not chucking that out. We're not saying, okay, listen, church, no more makeup. Listen, you can wear as much makeup as you want, but as much as you want to put on, is never going to be enough to cover up a heart that is ugly. So he's talking about the priority of being beautiful on the inside, more than just going for the things that are seen on the outside. For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God adorned themselves, being submissive to their husbands. So here we can sum this up by simply realizing this. Here's what he's saying. At the end of that sort of praise and pattern and purpose and priority, you got a couple of lines here. That God, first of all, he doesn't say to pack. He doesn't say, well, I think you should probably go home and pack. He doesn't say for you to quit or to pack or to bail. God doesn't say to pack or preach. Like, don't go home and preach. We used to give this book out in our premarital counseling called Do Yourself a Favor, Love Your Wife. And we gave out this other book, and we stopped giving them out because typically the wife-to-be would take the book that was written for her, and she would like dog-ear all of the pages that she wanted him to read. And maybe you're doing that. Maybe you're like, well, I'm not preaching, Bob. I could if you want. I've got a great message on this topic. I could. I'm not really, but I'm laying tracks out. I'm laying a track out on his bedside table, and you know, I'm making sure my Bible's open when he comes down for coffee in the morning on the kitchen table, and I'm making sure K-Wave's on the car when he gets in there, and I'm like, you're nagging him. Stop the nagging. God isn't saying go home and pack, and he isn't saying go home and preach. What's he saying? He's saying pursue. It's what Mike was just singing about. Let's pursue the things of the Lord. And know that as you're faithful to do so, something's going to happen. Your influence is going to sprout new branches and bear fruit for the glory of the Lord and for the good of your marriage. Namely, in four ways, and we'll close with this. The Christ-like influence of a bride's dependence. You're married to Jesus. Depend on him. Trust in him. Don't lean on your own understandings. Depend on him in all of your ways. Secondly, listen. The Christ-like influence of your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. That's what Peter means when he says, when they observe your chaste conduct. It means faithfulness. It means you're not going to run after some other dude and get your needs met over there in some emotional affair, or someone who's just like more of your soulmate. Stop. Just stop. And allow this washing of God's grace to come over your heart and heal your marriage and display an influence of faithfulness, of dependency, thirdly, of beauty. Of beauty. Of a beauty that is being birthed and born from the inside out. And lastly, of love. Look how it ends. Did you catch that at the end of verse 6? He says, if you do good and aren't afraid, it's a fearless love. It's a fearless love. Well, Bob, I'm afraid of this, honestly. If it's just being bold and transparent with you, I'm afraid to submit. I think if I submit to him, I'm going to be taken advantage of. Gosh, I can't tell you how many times I've heard that. I'll be taken advantage of if I submit to this guy. This guy's a train wreck. I'm afraid of this. I'm afraid of where this could lead. This is faith. This is trust. This is you like Peter stepping out of the boat, even in the midst of the darkness of night and the storms and the wind. It's stepping out in faith and depending that the Lord is with you. The Lord is for you. He's not against you. He's never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you. You can trust him with a fearless love. Perfect love casts out all fear. Well, I'm afraid of this, Bob. Just straight up, I'm afraid because I'm afraid of being lonely. Every wife in the room is. I'm afraid of being rejected. I'm afraid of being intimidated by this. I'm afraid to walk on a road less traveled. I'm afraid of losing out. I'm afraid of losing my identity. I'm afraid of being ostracized. All of which is exactly what Jesus faced when he went to the cross. and submitted himself, endured all of those things so that you would be set free. You have a Savior that even when you feel that way, even when you feel lonely, and you feel like you're all alone in this whole thing, he goes, I know exactly how that feels. I know how it feels to be lonely. I know how it feels to be afraid. I know how it feels to be rejected. I know how it feels to be intimidated. I know how it feels to lose your sense of identity. He was God stripped of all of his deity as well as his humanity. He was ostracized. He faced all of that so that you would never face any of it alone and in your own strength. He is here for you. If we would simply, in our lives, and all that makes our lives what our lives are, submit and surrender to his goodness and to his grace. Lord, we're going to celebrate communion now, and we're going to do so because it is the power that heals and saves, sets us free. I pray for each wife that is in this room, each husband that is here, each marriage that is represented, each family, every single person that is here. They would draw close to you and allow for there just to be a washing of your grace over their hearts and over their fears and over their lives and over their sins and mistakes, and just a refreshing that comes to us because you are a gracious and merciful God. This bread represents his body that was broken, by his stripes, our brokenness can be healed and restored and renewed. This cup represents his blood that was shed, that removes from us all of the stain of our sinful mistakes. Lord, wash us by your grace and renew us through the hope of your love, the power of your gospel to us this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, once we've all received from the men that are about to come forward in service, we're going to partake together. But in this moment, would you just bring your marriage before the Lord? Just bring your heart before the Lord as a husband, as a wife, as a mom, as a dad, as a single adult that is here, that is desiring someday for this to be. Pray for your spouse. Pray for your marriage. Pray for this moment to be lasting and eternal, that it would always be dependent upon and devoted to Jesus Christ. Amen? And once we've all been served, we'll partake together. Let's worship him.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Oh, Jesus, you're my hope instead.
This is our surrender. This is our submission to a Savior who has taken our place and offers for us in exchange of our sin, salvation by His grace. Amen. Would you stand with me as we partake? Lord, we just stand and pray more grace, Lord, over our marriages. More grace, Lord, poured into our lives. Just a wave of your grace washing over us. Your grace is sufficient for whatever we're faced with. However rough the storm might be and how hard the wind might be blowing, Lord, your grace is sufficient to see us through. And we submit to it. We surrender to it. We receive it gladly, gratefully, thankfully. Lord, we just pray your grace would prevail in every situation for your glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's partake together. Boy, a lot to consider, a lot to ponder, and a lot just to really be encouraged by through God's Word this morning. And, you know, in addition, I threw Esther some books that that might be helpful. It's Rachel Meyer's book here that I really love. It's called She Reads Truth. She Reads Truth. And you could pick that up in the bookshop. If I think there was quite a run on them after the 9 or last night's service, but we can order it for and get it for you. Here it is. Holding tight to permanence in a world that's passing away. And it really helped me. I love Rachel. I think she's great on that. And then we love Shauna Nyquist. Shauna Nyquist, part of our team, and close with Bob Goff and friends over the years, wrote a book called Present Over Perfect. Present, just being present over being perfect. None of us are. You just hang in there. Here's your subtitle. Leaving behind frantic for a simpler, more soulful way of living. Doesn't that sound great? Doesn't that sound awesome? So those are available, but you know, the book that I always recommend the most to you this week is Wives, I really hope that this morning helped. I hope it encourages you to stay in that marriage. And guys, I hope you come back next weekend for part 2. It can be a glorious time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Oh, Lord, I need